I'm going to open with a short scene from the 100 Penny Box, and then I'll talk about writing and what it has meant to me. It has literally saved my life. Sometimes I prefer living in a fantasy world, which may not even be a good thing to say, but which in fact is true, because so much around me can be harsh, and so sometimes it's easier to write. This is the beginning of the 100 Penny Box. Michael sat down on the bed that used to be his and watched his great-great-aunt, Aunt Du, rocking in the rocking chair. He wanted to play with the 100 Penny Box, especially since it was raining outside. Good thing I had that in there. But Aunt Du was singing that long song again, and sometimes when she sang it, she would forget who he was for a whole day. And then she would call him John. John was his father's name, and then his mother would say, "He's Mike, Aunt Du. His name is Michael. John's name is John. His name is Michael." But if his father was at home, Aunt Du would just say, "Where's my boy?" And then it was hard to tell whether she meant him or his father. And he would have to wait until she said something more before he knew which one she meant. Aunt Du didn't call his mother any name at all. Michael had heard his father and mother talking in bed late one night, and it was soon after they had come from going to Atlanta to bring back Aunt Du. "She won't even look at me, won't say my name, won't call my name, nothing," his mother had said, and Michael could tell that his mother had been crying. "She doesn't like me. I know it, I can tell. I do everything I can to make her comfortable." His mother was crying hard. "I rode half the way across the city, all the way to Mama D's, to get some homemade ice cream, some decent ice cream. Mama D said the ice cream be melted before you get home. So I took a cab back and made her lunch and gave her the ice cream. I sat down at the table and tried to drink my coffee. I mean, I wanted to talk with her, say something, but she just sat there and ate that ice cream and looked straight ahead at the wall and never said nothing to me. She talks to Mike, and if I come around, she even stops talking sometimes." His mother didn't say anything for a while, and then he heard her say, "I care about her, but she's making me miserable in my own home." Michael heard his father say the same thing he always said about Aunt Du. "She's a 100-year-old lady, baby." Sometimes his mother would add, "And when I didn't have nobody, she was there. Look here. After Big John and Junie drowned, she gave me a home because I didn't have one. I didn't have nothing. I've loved her all my life like I love you. And that tough little beautiful boy we made standing right outside the door and listening for all he's worth, and he's supposed to be in his room asleep." Michael remembered he had run back to his room and gotten back into bed and gotten up again and tiptoed over to the bedroom door to close it a little and shut a little of the light shining from the bathroom onto Aunt Du's face. And then he looked at Aunt Du and wished she'd wake up and talk to him like she did when she felt like talking, and telling him all kinds of stories about people. "Hold tight, Ruth," he had heard his father say. "She knows we want her. She knows it. And baby, baby, sweet woman, you're doing fine. Everything you're doing is right." Then Michael could hear the covers moving where his mother and father were, and he knew his father was putting his arms around his mother because sometimes he saw them asleep in the morning, and that's the way they looked. But he was tired of remembering now, and he was tired of Aunt Du singing and singing and singing. "Aunt Du," Michael whispered close to his great-great-aunt's wrinkled face, "can we play with the 100 Penny Box?" "Precious Lord." "Aunt Du, let's count the pennies out." "Take my hand." "Aunt Du, lead me on." Michael thought for a moment,
and he knew the large wooden box was down beside the dresser on the floor where he could easily get it, except it was no fun to count the pennies alone. It was only better when Aunt Du whacked him a little and said, "Stop right there, boy. You know what that penny means?" And he'd say, "You tell me," and she'd tell him. But when she started singing, it was hard to stop her. At least when she was dancing what she called moving to the music, she'd get tired after a while. And then she would tell him about the pennies and help count them too. Michael cupped his large hands. Everybody talked about how large his hands were for his age, around his great-great-aunt's ear. "Aunt Du," he said loudly. Aunt Du stopped rocking hard and turned and looked at him. But he didn't say anything, and she didn't say anything. Aunt Du turned her head and began to sing again, exactly where she had left off. "Let me stand." Michael moved away from the rocking chair and sat back down on the bed. Then he got up and went to the dresser. He reached down and picked up the heavy, scratched-up 100-penny box from the floor, walked to the bedroom door, and stood there for a moment before he went out. There was no way to stop Aunt Du once she started singing that long song. He walked down the hall and held the huge box against his stomach. He could still hear Aunt Du's voice. "I am weak, I am worn." "What's wrong?" his mother asked when he walked into the kitchen and sat down on a chair and stared at the floor. He didn't even want to answer. "Oh," his mother said, and reached for the 100-penny box in his arms. "Give me that thing," she said. "That goes today. Soon as Aunt Du's sleep, that goes in the furnace." Michael almost jumped out the chair. He wouldn't let go of that big old heavy box. He could hear his great-great-aunt's voice, and she was singing louder. "Lead me through the night, precious Lord, take my hand." "You can't take that 100-penny box," Michael cried. "I'll tell Daddy if you take it and burn it up in the furnace like you burned up all the rest of Aunt Du's stuff." Then Michael thought of all the things he and Aunt Du had hidden in the closet, and he almost told his mother. And his mother walked closer to him and stood there, but he wasn't afraid. Nobody was going to take Aunt Du's 100-penny box. Nobody, nobody, nobody. "Aunt Du's like a child," his mother said quietly. "She's like you. Thinks she needs a whole lot of stuff. She really doesn't. I'm not taking her pennies. You know I wouldn't take her pennies. I'm just getting rid of that big, old, ugly wooden box always underfoot." Michael stood up. "No," he said. "Mike, did you say no to me?" his mother asked. She put her hands on her hips. I mean, Michael said and tried to think fast, "Aunt Du won't go to sleep if she doesn't see her box in the corner. Can I take it back? And then you can let her see it. And when she goes to sleep, you can take it." "Go put it back in her room then," his mother said. "I'll get it later." "Okay," Michael said, and held that heavy box tighter than ever and walked slowly back down the hall to the small bedroom that used to be his. He opened the door and went in, put the 100-penny box down on the floor, sat down on it, staring at his aunt. She wasn't singing now, just sitting. "John Boy," she said. "Yes, Aunt Du," Michael answered, and didn't care this time that she was calling him John again. He was trying to think. "Put my music on, boy." The music wasn't going to help him think, because the first thing she was going to do was to make him move, too. But Michael got off the 100-penny box and reached under his bed and took out his blue record player that he had got for his birthday. He had already plugged it in the wall when he heard her say, "Give me that. Get mine. My own Victrola. The one your father gave me." "Mama threw it out," Michael said, and knew he had told her already a lot of times. "It was broken." Aunt Du squeezed her lips real tight together. "Your mama gonna throw me out soon," she said. Michael stood up and stared at his great-great-aunt. "Mama can't throw people out," he said. "Put my music on, boy, and be quick about it." okay, Michael said, and turned the record player on and got the record, Andrew's favorite, that they had saved and hidden in the bottom drawer. The dusty, chipped record was of a lady singing that long song, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Michael turned it down real low. Aunt Du started humming, and Michael sat down in the bed and tried to think about what he'd do with the 100-penny box. Aunt Du got up from the rocking chair and stood up. She held her arms down by her sides and made her thin hands into fists and clenched her lips tight and moved real slow in one spot. Get up, John Boy, she said. Get up and move with me. Move with Dubette Thomas. I don't feel like dancing, Michael said, and kept sitting on the bed. But he watched his great-great-aunt move both her thin arms to one side and then the other, and move her hands about and hold her dress. And then she stopped and started all of a sudden again, just swinging her arms and moving her shoulders up and down and singing some more. And each time the record ended, he'd have to start it again. When he was playing it for the third time, he said, Aunt Du, where will you put your 100 pennies if you lose your 100-penny box? When I lose my 100-penny box, I lose me, she said, and kept moving herself from side to side and humming.